nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living Lord. Your presence, Lord. I taste it.
Trust what you say, that you're good. Please read this scripture with me from Isaiah. Even youths shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not be faint.
My soul, my Savior.
may be seated.
I thought he was just batteries. Let's see here. All right. We'll preach until the batteries wear out, and then we'll just keep preaching. All right. Now we can pray. Father in heaven, thank you for this day. Thank you for the invitation to be part of your family, to come into your household, and to be part of your people. Lord, that's nothing we can accomplish on our own. And nothing we would desire on our own if you had not extended the invitation. So, Lord, we thank you for your grace. And we thank you for your mercy and for covering us in your love. Lord, we pray that you'd help us to be people that are transformed by that love, transformed by your word as we approach you through how you've spoken throughout the generations in your word today. Lord, we pray that you'd be with our church friends, our family, those who are at home, those who are undergoing difficulties through this last year, and especially those who are in danger of the COVID pandemic. And so, Lord, we just pray for a blessing of health and safety on our church friends, on our church family, on our homes. Help us to live with wisdom and with love for you and for our neighbor. And we pray all this in Jesus' name together. Amen. Look, did that happen while I was praying? Wow. It's like, God provides. So, if we need them, we'll come back to batteries. All right, so we're going to be in Exodus chapter 7 through 10 today. Don't worry, I'm not going to read the whole thing and preach the whole thing. Wish that I would, wish that I could, but we don't have enough batteries to do all four chapters. But I'd encourage you this week in your home, maybe even with your family, just take some time. It's not long to read through chapters 7 through 10, but we're just going to look at a little part of Exodus chapter 7 today to give us a taste of the signs and wonders that God performs in the land of Egypt as he frees his people. So while you get your sermon notes out, get your sermon notes ready, find Exodus chapter 7 in your Bible. What I want you to consider for just a moment is when was the last time that you were like just really, truly amazed? Was really amazed at something. And while you think for just a moment, I'll tell you mine. The other day, I was coming back from Georgetown. I used the new little Southwest bypass that they've created there in Georgetown. And so I took the Southwest bypass coming from the Northwest over this way, took the little bypass through, and that little bypass cuts through part of the big limestone quarry that's over here, just a few miles away. And so sometimes you can see that limestone quarry from the freeway, or you can see just a little bit of it. But if you take this bypass, it lets you in through just a corner of that quarry, and it was almost worth like pulling over for just a minute, because I've seen places like the Grand Canyon and some other places like that. What they have done there, like over however many years they've been doing stuff there, at least 40 or 50 years, just to look at how much limestone they've excavated over the years was like amazing. Like just like human hands, machinery, planning, engineering, all that kind of stuff, just to look at it. And then I get home, I look at Google Maps, and that Southwest bypass that goes through there, you only see like a fraction of what's been done, you know, across that whole place. So to me, that was just amazing. Maybe not like God amazing that he, you know, did it, but just to think that much work, that much effort, it was just, you know, really something amazing to me. So anybody else? Last time, I know that nothing can compare to that, right? Rocks out of the ground. Anybody been truly amazed recently? Or can you think back to a moment where you were really amazed? Nobody? Steve? Watching the birth of your children. That's amazing, right? We have, like, way to go, moms. Yeah, that's awesome. And you have five, right? So, fantastic. Lance is one of them. He's got his hand up next. Air show? To go to the air show, see some awesome stuff in planes and pilots doing some pretty amazing things, so that's good. Anybody else been amazed recently, or even just remember back to a time that you were amazed? Snowpocalypse, yeah. 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 Our good friend Kieran, who like started worshiping around January, is like, oh, welcome to Texas, man. The weather's great. There's like two of our snowstorms already since then, so Glad you're here, Kieran. All right. The reason that I asked that is in all of the scriptures, there are lots of amazing moments, but this moment of God's 10 signs and wonders as he frees his people from Egypt is in the top two. And the other one lays on top of it just as a pattern, and that's the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. They both take place at this moment of Passover. And so as we understand and look at this moment today, God's intention is for this moment in Israel's history and for this moment as us to go back and look on it to be one of those moments where we say, that is all out amazing. That's marvelous. That's a spectacle. There was nothing like this ever in the pages of Scripture before then and after then, other than the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. So that's our hope today. All right, I don't know if I can accomplish it, but that's the hope, at least, that that we should be leaving with when we get through this moment of Scripture. So a couple things in your notes, if you haven't been with us the last couple of weeks, to get up to Exodus chapter 7. In the big picture of the story, many generations ago, Joseph, through God's leading, brings his family into Egypt. So it was God's idea for them to be here in Egypt. And through Joseph, God saves Egypt. There's a famine everywhere else in the world, and through the knowledge and wisdom of Joseph being able to interpret Pharaoh's dreams, they store up enough food to provide for Egypt and for the surrounding nations. Everyone comes to Egypt to say, "Let us buy grain from you." God saved this people. They owe him, right? They should remember him. They should honor God. That's his purpose. He amazed them once, and he's going to amaze them again. So in your notes, go ahead and write this, Steve. The Hebrew people went from being honored in Egypt. They were given the best land in Egypt, the land of Goshen, all right? It's like where you wanted to live if you were going to live in Egypt. Joseph and his family, his brothers, they were all given this land of Goshen. They were honored in Egypt. But over time, in the 250 years that they were in Egypt, Pharaoh came a new Pharaoh who didn't know Joseph, didn't know the family, didn't know the story, didn't have any of that amazement, didn't have any of that knowledge, that history, and they begin to grow resentful of this people who have the best land among us, right? Filthy rich people. They grow resentful of them. And so instead they turn them into slaves. And so that slavery in Egypt is going to last 75 or 100 years out of the 250 years that they're in Egypt. So everybody got that part of the story? That's kind of how we got to this moment. And then God spends about 80 years of that getting Moses prepared to be the redeemer of his people. 40 years in the palace, 40 years in the wilderness, and now Moses is ready, God is ready, Pharaoh's ready, everything is ready for God's redemption of his people. So next in your notes, in Exodus 7 through 10, the time has come where God begins to take action against Pharaoh in Egypt. We left off just on a real disappointing, sour note last week, which is that God said he's going to redeem everybody, and they say, "No, you're not. You haven't done it yet. You keep saying you're going to do it." And Moses tries to tell them that God is about to redeem us. He's going to do something amazing. And because of their broken spirit, they can't even respond. They can't even believe. They're so broken in their spirit by their slavery. So God has taken everyone in the story to an all-time low so that they can be prepared to be astonished. So let's read in Exodus chapter 7. We'll read verses 1 through 13. And the Lord said to Moses, "See, I have made you like God to Pharaoh. And your brother Aaron shall be your prophet. You shall speak all that I command you. And your brother Aaron shall tell Pharaoh to let the people of Israel go out of his land. But I will harden Pharaoh's heart. And though I multiply my signs and wonders in the land of Egypt, Pharaoh will not listen to you. Then I will lay my hand on Egypt and bring my hosts, my people, the children of Israel, out of the land of Egypt by great acts of judgment. The Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord when I stretch out my hand against Egypt and bring out the people of Israel from among them." Moses and Aaron did so. They did just as the Lord commanded them. Now Moses was 80 years old and Aaron was 83 years old when they spoke to Pharaoh. Then the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, "When Pharaoh says to you, 'Prove yourselves by working a miracle, then you shall say to Aaron, take your staff and cast it down before Pharaoh, that it may become a serpent. So Moses and Aaron went to Pharaoh and did just as the Lord commanded. Aaron cast down his staff before Pharaoh and his servants, and it became a serpent. Then Pharaoh summoned the wise men and their sorcerers, and they, the magicians of Egypt, also did the same by their secret arts. For each man cast down his staff, and they became serpents. But Aaron's staff swallowed up their staffs. Still Pharaoh's heart was hardened, and he would not listen to them, as the Lord had said. So that's all we're going to read for today. We'll look at a couple of verses in the next chapters coming up. But I would encourage you this week and this weekend upcoming, in a week from now, is the weekend of Passover. So it's a great story to read in your home, maybe all at once, or just a little bit of a couple of the signs and wonders of God each night on our way through the next week. But I just want to break down a couple of ideas, some very common questions that come out of this passage and out of the next couple chapters. And so you can see that God is beginning this work, and even one of the signs and wonders that doesn't get included in the top 10 is this moment where the snakes are thrown down. It's a little bit of a foretaste of Pharaoh's people have some power, but God has greater power. God has greater ability. And so this one snake that's from the staff is going to swallow up the snakes that are provided by Pharaoh's magicians and sorcerers. So it gets you a little bit of a foretaste that of what's coming. Now, we are supremely spoiled by Scripture. You need to know that, all right? Because we know how many signs and wonders there are, right? You know how many there are? Okay, good. All right. So we know that there's 10. So it's like we're living the drama, but we know like what's going to happen. But you can imagine, like, I don't want to scare anybody, but like we've had like 2 snowstorms. Like, like what if there were 10? Right? Like, so Israel and Egypt are both living in this moment of not knowing how many there are, not knowing just how deep this is going to go and how difficult it's going to be to continue to remain in faith. But God is going to do for Israel the kinds of things he needs to do to sustain their faith throughout these 10 signs and wonders. So first thing in your notes, now that we've read Exodus chapter 7, God makes his purpose very clear in this passage and in the coming chapters. Read this as a family. You'll see this over and over. God says this over and over in this passage. He also says this over and over in the Bible. God's purpose now, just as it was then, is to make himself known in all the world. His purpose in providing for Egypt, right, in providing for them in the season before the famine and giving them a time of harvest was so that all nations could come and hear that God, this God of Joseph, had provided for them. So this isn't the first time that God has tried to make himself known among the nations and among the people of the world. This is God's big purpose. Behind every snowpocalypse, behind every pandemic, behind everything that we experience, God's one purpose is that we would stop looking around and that we would look up or look inside and recognize that there is a God who's trying to get our attention. In the last year, unusual, unknown, difficult year, if God has not gotten your attention, I don't know what else he could do. Does anybody agree with me on that? Like, I don't know, right? Like, if your prayer life hasn't increased in the last year, I'm all out of ideas, right? And so God's going to do the same thing here to Pharaoh, just over and over to get his attention, to get the attention of the people, and to get the attention of the nations in the world. We see this in Revelation. There are these 4 horsemen of the apocalypse. Everyone kind of gets, you know, freaked out about what they are and what they're doing, but you go through the pattern in Revelation and you see these cycles of God trying to get the attention of the world. And you see this phrase over and over that says, God pours out wrath, he pours out judgment, he preaches and all these kind of things. But the people did not repent. So he goes through another cycle to get their attention. Famine, war, disease, judgments. But the people did not repent. So God's purpose then as it is now is to make himself known. We love it when he makes himself known by pouring out feast in a time of famine, right? Everybody loves that. Amen. They even love that in Jesus' time. Multiply bread and fish. Yeah, we love Jesus. He's awesome. Forgive your neighbor. Pray for those who persecute you. Nah, I need a different Messiah. All right, I need a different religion. I need a different faith other than this one. So God is wanting to make himself known, but you have to accept him fully. The wrath, the judgment comes along with the mercy. So God's purpose is to make himself known in all of the world. A couple chapters ahead of this, in Exodus 10, you'll see this verse here, that you may tell in the hearing of your son and of your grandson how I have dealt harshly with the Egyptians and what signs I have done among them, that you may know that I am the Lord. I was so amazed by the limestone quarry excavation that I saw that I didn't tell anybody until just today. Right? You think it'll ever make it into the conversation with my son and grandson? Probably not, you know. The air show, Lance, remember, all right, in future, tell your son and your grandson. Was it that amazing? I mean, it was probably pretty amazing. The birth of your child, that's probably good. That's probably going to make it, all right. Good job, Steve. You were truly amazed, all right. But here's God saying, I'm doing something in this generation that's beyond just this generation. I want to do something in your life that you will tell your children about and your grandchildren. When your grandchildren do come over for the holidays, they do come visit you in your house, and you've got that moment to speak to them, I hope it's about something of greater importance than just, we got to go see the Grand Canyon of Georgetown, right? We got to get over there and check it out. So God wants to do something in Israel and in Egypt that's going to last beyond the current moment, last beyond the generations, and that is the salvation of a nation. Next in your notes, after Exodus chapter 10, verse 2, what we see in these signs is that these are judgments against Egypt. God uses this word that my signs and my wonders, that these are judgments against Egypt. Now, you need to know this about Scripture, and you need to know this about the God who loves us. He never, as many times as you want to write that in your notes, all right? God never brings judgment where he hasn't first brought conviction. Does that make sense? He never just shows up and says, you've all been bad. You're all getting whoopings, all right? Doesn't just show up for wrath time. Doesn't just show up for judgment time. When God shows up for judgment, it means I've been calling you. I've been speaking to you. I've been trying to get your attention. I've convicted you in your heart about what's right or wrong, and you've persisted. You've continued in this. The same thing happens with Sodom and Gomorrah. A lot of people know the story of Sodom and Gomorrah. Wow, God shows up and really torched the place. Guess what? Abraham had saved them like years before. He went through and destroyed the evil kings. He rescued those cities. They should know this God. They should be asking Abraham, like, where's this miraculous stuff come from? And they probably did at first, but they weren't amazed over time. They didn't tell their son, they didn't tell their grandson, and so they start to look at these Hebrews and these Israelites as, you know, as despicable, and they don't follow that God. Same thing happens in the conquest in the book of Joshua. We see, oh, God's bringing war, and he's, you know, going to these cities. But you read through the Scripture. Every city that they came to offered terms of peace. Every city you come to, say, there's a great and wonderful God. He's given us this land. If you want to be part of him and his family, his tribe, his people, you're welcome to. And God says, I'll send my spirit like a hornet before you. So that some people are going to, they're going to freak out and say, we don't want part of this war. We don't want part of this. And they'll flee. So when you get to the point where you make war upon a city, they've rejected terms of peace. They've rejected the Spirit's calling and openness in their life. Like you're left with the unrepentant. So God does this over and over in Scripture. When you see that God's bringing judgment, it means I've called, I've emailed, I've done everything that I can to call you into relationship with me. So these signs are judgment against Egypt for their idolatry and for their slavery. And not just idolatry and slavery, but anything else you want to pile into their sin. God has been speaking to them, and they have been resistant and repentant. Especially in Exodus, what we just read in chapter 7, verse 11, this power, dark spiritual power that Pharaoh's magicians and sorcerers have. So go ahead, Steve, show us that verse again. Then Pharaoh summoned the wise men and the sorcerers, and they, the magicians of Egypt, also did the same by their secret arts. So not only is God calling them, saying, I'm convicting you of your sin, but they increased in their own evil ways to work against God. A couple things that we see in these 10 signs and wonders. The first two signs are reproduced by Pharaoh's magicians. They're able to turn water into blood. They're able to make frogs out of water. So that's pretty dark spiritual power, right? That's pretty dark spiritual power. If they really had power, they would reverse the plague, right? If their God really had power, they would turn the Nile back into water. They would send frogs back to where they came from. But God limits the evil in this world in this way. You want more of the evil? Yeah, more of the evil. You want to reverse it? Only God does that. It's an awesome moment that God says, reversing evil. I don't share that power, right? I don't give that away. But you want to multiply evil? You can have it. The third sign, the magicians begin to proclaim, I think this is the finger of God. I think this is the hand of God at work among us. At the fourth sign, God begins separating the land where the Hebrews live from the land where the rest of Egypt. So those plagues and those signs and those wonders begin to only impact those who are resistant to God. The people of faith are protected. With the fifth sign, Moses starts to give a warning. He says, get your livestock inside. I'll show you that you can participate in relationship with God by faith. The first four signs haven't convinced you yet. God's going to give you an opportunity. Take your livestock inside. And if you don't, then that plague will affect them. At this moment, the signs go from difficult to destructive. The sixth plague gets very personal, boils on the skin. The sixth plague was unannounced. At this one, you just see, like, God speaks to Moses, let's just skip the Pharaoh thing, right? Let's just eliminate the middleman. And the sixth plague is unannounced, and it comes from the ashes of the kilns. You remember last week's story about bricks? No more, Pharaoh says, no more straw. You could get your own straw to make these bricks. And so God uses the ashes from the kiln, and Moses takes some of those ashes and sprinkles them in the air to bring this plague of boils on the skin to Egypt. Pharaoh's magicians and servants at this point, because of their own sickness and unhealth and uncleanliness, can no longer stand before Pharaoh. Guess who the only people who get to stand before Pharaoh anymore are? Moses and Aaron. Not fun when your only two friends, right, are Moses and Aaron, and you stand against God, and they're the only people who can come before you. The seventh sign of hail and fire also comes with advanced warning. The separation is now not just Israel and Egypt, but the separation is now believers and non-believers. God never had a problem with Egypt, right? God never has a problem with a nation or a race. God's problem is with those who believe and those who resist. So God opens this up for Egypt to say, anybody who wants in, you can have in. Just listen to my words and obey. The eighth sign of locusts, Pharaoh's servants begin begging Pharaoh to give up, right? Begging Pharaoh to give up, to listen to Moses and not go back and forth with the hardening of his heart. And for today, at least, we'll end with the ninth sign. Darkness over the land. Moses tells Pharaoh after the ninth sign, I will never see your face again. It's coming to an end. It's coming to a conclusion. And that's not just because of the darkness, but because God is bringing an ending to these signs and to these wonders. God is bringing an ending to his patience with sinners, to his patience with those who resist him. And so we see 10 signs and wonders, which is very gracious, right? After 75 years of slavery and captivity, of these dark magical arts and this sin that's pervasive in Pharaoh's heart, like 10's pretty gracious, you know? Like sometimes we do the thing with our kids, like I'm going to give you to the count of three. Like 10's pretty gracious, you know? Like I'm not patient enough to count to 10. Like I'm going to lose my mind between 1 and 10, all right? So 5's pretty good. 3's fair, you know? God is willing to go to the 10th degree with Pharaoh and his people. Next in your notes, the hardening of Pharaoh's heart. A lot of people have questions about this. How is it that a good God, a loving God, can go into a situation and just say, like, I'm going to harden your heart. Like, there's no chance for repentance. There's no freedom for you. I'm gonna harden your heart. We see this in Scripture, that God can raise up a person, an individual, for his purposes, but they're still accountable for what they do. So sometimes God raises up a Pharaoh, like, nobody complained when the nice Pharaoh let Joseph in, right? God raised him up for that. God raised him up and said, I need a Pharaoh at that moment. I'll give you a Pharaoh at that moment who says, yeah, help us out, right? Love to help you. You help us, I help you, bring your family. Nobody complains when God is overly gracious. But God can also be, what's the best way to say it? He's sovereign. That's the way to say it. God is sovereign. If he wants to raise up 10 bowling pins that he's going to knock down, guess what? He can do that. It's his creation, all right? But God does this in the prophets over and over. He says, I'll bring a king from the north, or I'll bring a king from the east, and he'll destroy you. He'll punish you because of your sin. But then when it's over, I'll punish him because he picked on my people, right? They're completely accountable. We're all completely accountable for what we do. Pharaoh is never taken off of the hot seat in accountability in this way. And this is can be hard for us to grasp, but this is God in his sovereignty can raise up an object for blessing, or he can raise up an object for destruction. And this is the way that the author of Hebrews reminds us in the same way. And I think Paul writes about this in Romans as well. Romans 9, chapter 17, speaking about this same moment. The Lord says to Pharaoh, for this very purpose I have raised you up, that I might show my power in you, and that my name might be proclaimed in all the earth. So then he has mercy on whomever he wills, and he hardens whomever he wills. In the same passage in other places, God says, does the pot have any right to point fingers at the potter? The best thing to do is to trust and obey, be repentant, and say, would you make something good out of me? I don't want to be an object of wrath. I don't want to be raised up for destruction only. So Pharaoh's never taken off of the hot seat. He's never taken away from accountability in this. Egypt, after this 100 years of slavery and idolatry and this practice of dark arts, God is going to do something amazing through these 10 signs and wonders. But the hardening of Pharaoh's heart is never an excuse. Pharaoh is never taken away from accountability for his own sins. Next in your notes, you see these first 9 signs. These are directed at Egypt's pantheon of God. So Egypt is one of those places, just kind of like when you look at Greek and Roman gods, there's just like no ending to the list of how many of them there are, how many sons and daughters of gods had, how many of them intermarried with each other, had other sons and daughters and different kinds of things. And so Egypt is that way. You'll see different lists. Like I'll give you like one version. It's never really mentioned in Scripture which god an individual sign or wonder is directed against. Some of them could have been multiple gods, but some of them do have some very direct imagery with Israel, with Egypt's pantheon of gods, because they had multiple, many gods in their place. So this is what I recognized at my house the other day. No judgment, no blame on anyone, but there's a place where I typically sit at one of the tables in our house, and I went to sit there this morning, and as I went to sit there this morning and make this PowerPoint and drink some coffee, I recognized that, kind of like the Three Little Bears, like somebody had sat there before me, which is okay, right? I want people to sit there, all right? But I could tell that whoever sat there before me, first of all, wasn't me, all right? There was like I think jelly and butter, you know, down there. And, like, we had a lot of kids over at our house. Like, it could be my wife, you know, who knows? It's like, could have been our dog. She's been on the table before, so. Anyway, I'm sitting there, and I'm just like, this is my spot, but this isn't my spot, right? Like, this isn't what my spot is supposed to look like. So I cleaned up that spot. As you go through these signs and wonders, God is kind of sitting there, like, looking at the throne of Egypt to say, like, that's my spot. It's clouded, you know, and it's crowded with idolatry. But if there's any throne in any place on this earth, be it physical or personal, God's looking at it to say, like, let's let's clean up the jelly here, all right? And we'll sit down, and when I'm on the throne of your life, we'll make it right. And it'll be right, and it'll be good. So in order, as you go through these plagues, Hapi is a fun name, right? Hapi is the Egyptian god of the Nile. This goddess is a water bearer. And so first to go after the Nile River in the first plague is an attack on their nation, on their fertility, on their beliefs. Hecate is a goddess of water and fertility. Hecate is depicted with the head of a frog. So as you look at Egyptian icons, a lot of times you see their gods and goddesses as a human body with a different head, like an animal head, a dog head, or a crocodile head. And so Hecate has this head of a frog. If you've ever seen frog eggs, I mean, they just kind of multiply in these little bubbles. And so on the Nile River, having a place like that, they just kind of recognize that the frog eggs are part of fertility. It means good things. There's stuff alive. Stuff is breeding. It's, you know, springtime. And so that second plague of frogs has the imagery of one of their gods. Geb is a god over all the earth, god over dust and dirt. So even though you have this river system, they still rely on rainwater. I've kind of recognized this. I love it when it rains here, but sometimes I need it to rain like an hour northwest, all right? Like, if you want Lake Georgetown to get filled, if it rains here, like, what rains here goes to Granger, right? But what you need is rain in certain areas. And so Geb, this god over the earth and dust, is in the list of gods of Egypt who are attacked throughout these. Khafre is a god of creation and rebirth, has the head of a fly. The fourth plague is a plague of flies. The fifth plague that we see coordinates with Hathor, is a goddess of love and a goddess of protection. She's like a mother. And so as people start to get boils on their skin, like when you're upset, when you're hurt, when you're like, I mean, dads are cool, but when you're hurt and upset and sick, you want mom. And so they have this goddess she's also depicted with a jar of water or a jar of milk. She's like a mom who's caring for her family. And so as these people are sickened with boils on their skin, their goddess of love and protection has nothing to offer them. Isis is a goddess of medicine and peace, also a comforting a mother. Hathor, the one before, has the head of a cow. Nut is a goddess of the sky, offers no protection over the destructive hail, offers no rain when the hail turns to fire. Seth is a god of storms and chaos, and is helpless when the sky and the wind bring locusts to consume whatever crops are left over. And then the last two, at least the ninth plague, and then the tenth, the Passover. Ra is the most worshipped god in all of Egypt, second only to Pharaoh himself. So this is one of those cultures where whoever's in charge is the son of the gods. So Pharaoh is the son of the gods himself, would be worshipped the most. But this plague of darkness over the land is an attack on the greatest of their gods, Ra, the most worshipped god in Egypt, second only to Pharaoh himself. And Ra is completely eclipsed by this darkness. And in fact, you know that there's light shining only on Israel's people, right? It's almost like, hey, that God we love, Ra, really likes them. He really likes that. I'm like, I'm going to go over and be with that group of people. And especially over those last several plagues where there's protection for God's people, it's going to start to look like the gods of Egypt first are not able to do anything, but it's going to look like only the God of the Hebrews can do what we thought our gods could do. Isaiah chapter 41, verse 29 tells us this, as God looks upon idols and and idolatry in the world. He says, behold, they are all a delusion. Their works are nothing. Their metal images are empty wind. Everywhere on earth where there's idolatry, paganism, and spiritual worship of things other than God, he looks on this and says, like, you made that. Like, you actually made that. Like, you created that. You came up with that. But it's God himself who brings rain. It's God himself who created plants, gives the biology and nature for all the accomplishments that we build our lives on. There'd be nothing at HEB if it were not for God providing, all right? Everything, when you boil it down and get down to the provider, is God himself. The message today remains. Through these events, through these powers, these signs and wonders of God, the most important thing I can tell you is not about Pharaoh and not about frogs and not about the Nile River. As interesting as it is, in that moment and for those people, God used those signs and God used those wonders to get their attention and to demonstrate the greatness of his power over all things. So today we would say, God's got more power than the weatherman, right? He's got more power than the public utility corporation. He's got more power than whatever governor, whatever, you know, county official, whatever mandates get made, whatever laws get passed. There's a God above and behind all of that. And the good news is that he loves you. He loves me. He loves the person who put jelly on my table, right? He's overwhelming with love. But there are these moments in life where he says, I'm going to count to 10. And I'm going to give you an opportunity to have a relationship with me. I want to have a relationship with you. But if you persist, the message today remains, sin in our lives brings death and separation from God. And God will bring judgment for that hardened heart. But he'll also bring grace for the repentant. When Christ himself was on the cross, one of those Roman guards looked at him and said, same thing that the magicians say, right? I think this is the hand of God. I think this is the Son of God. Like, we crucified the wrong guy. But in that moment, Jesus on the cross is saying, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. I mean, God is full of grace for us. When we've gone to our own secret arts, our own deceptions, our own ways out, God is willing to call us back into truth and into righteousness. Today, if you've not made a decision, if you've not heard this call from a loving God, I'd love to talk with you more about who God is and how he has come to save us. This is the greatest Old Testament moment. Through these 10 signs and wonders of God into the Passover that we'll see next. And when Jesus came to offer his life for us, God put his pattern of life right on top of this very moment in the calendar of Israel. What Jesus accomplished for us took place at Passover. The night before he was crucified, Jesus had a Passover meal with his disciples. They were all thinking about Israel's history, and God is thinking about their future. He's thinking about your future today. We're going to share communion together because it's in this moment where Jesus kind of demonstrates the greatness of his love. Instead of this Passover of Egypt, where Egypt paid for their sin, Jesus Christ loves us so much that he would be willing in his body, with his blood, to take on the consequences of our sin and our rebellion to God. Let's pray, and then we'll take communion together. Father, we thank you so much that through the pages of Scripture, we see your mighty hand at work. And Lord, help us as we go through these pages of history just to remember that you are a God of the present, and that even today you can still move mountains, God, that nothing is beyond you, and that greater than all of those is your love for us and your faithfulness to your people. Lord, thank you for coming to take our place on the cross, to give us freedom and life and mercy and grace. We thank you for this today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. This is the body of bread which is broken for us. I'll take this in remembrance of him. and his blood which was poured out at the cross for us. Take this in remembrance of him. Steve, I think I left one slide out. So let's read from Hebrews chapter 3. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion. And the sad story is that some of those people who witnessed these 10 signs a month later are saying, God hates us. God's abandoned us. God has forgotten us. So whatever happens this next week, this next month, this next year, do not think that God has abandoned you, left you, or forgotten you. His love for us remains strong. We'll stand together. We'll close with a blessing. We have a couple of announcements. I know we've got some crafts over here in the community room. We are attempting to make a whole bunch of crafts to take to Trinity Care Center so that we can give some little Easter uplifting goodies to the folks over there. So if you have some time to do some crafts this week, there are craft kits in the community room. If you've got kids at home, they can help you out in making those. If you have questions about that, you can talk to Heidi. And then also next week in worship, our kids choir is going to sing on Palm Sunday, so get connected with Heidi or Joanna, because Heidi might have some baby duty up in up in Dallas with family. So let's stand together, and we'll close with this blessing. Therefore, my beloved brothers and sisters, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. Go in peace, friends.